Happy Mother's Day. Let's all get on our feet, worship the Lord. Let's put our hands together. Let's go, everybody, up. Solid ground. Jesus is the only thing that matters. I'm gonna leave everything else behind today. Let's just worship the Lord right now. Let's sing this out to Him.
Our God, firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. Nations rise and fall, kingdoms be strong now shaken. We trust forever in Your name, in the name of Jesus.
Gift of life. We're so grateful for all the kiddos that are a byproduct of that, and One of the ways throughout church history that gratitude has been expressed to God has been through worship and through singing. And we have the honor of doing that, continuing to do that today here at Woodmark. We want to cultivate hearts of worship and gratitude. And so for our call to worship, we're going to read out of Psalm 149, where the writer speaks of the goodness of God. He focuses his attention, and so we want to do that as well together. So let's read this. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the godly. Let Israel be glad in his maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with salvation. Let the godly exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their beds. Amen.
Place
What gift of love could I offer to a king? What a weight of worth could be held within my offering? When he alone is worthy, a glory song is inscribed upon my heart. This treasure held in an alabaster jar, I break to bring him all the glory.
Worship you, to honor you, and to be in your presence. Jesus, today, my heart. heart is grateful for the gift of mothers in our lives and in our community. Father, today my heart is grateful for the gift of community. Lord, this community that we can be a part of, that we can call Woodmark. Lord, I thank you for the gift of your presence and the gift of your word that comes to renew us, that comes to strengthen us. Lord, I thank you for the gift of a new day. And your word says that your mercies are renewed every morning. Thank you for the gift of a new day. Lord, yesterday, Lord, we could have had tears and, Lord, and done some things that can bring shame and guilt. But, Lord, you send a new day. You send your grace and mercy, and it is renewed to us every morning. And so this morning, Lord, we thank you for the gift of a new day. Holy Spirit, we pray for your presence with us in this service. Lord, minister to every heart today, God. Bless every family and every individual in this room with us today. Lord, may your work do a work in us and in our hearts. Lord, that our posture, our mindset, Lord, will be set on you. Father, that our heart may be brought back to repentance, Lord, and worship of you, our Lord and Savior. Lord, daily in our walk, that we would be practicing resurrection, practicing, Lord, living out your word in light of what you've done, in light of the fact that you are alive and have been resurrected from the dead. Holy Spirit, bless this gathering, bless this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team. That was beautiful. Thank you all for being with us. You may be seated. Welcome to Woodmark Church. My name is Russell, and this is my wonderful wife, Tanya. So excited to have you with us today, and we're excited to celebrate this day with you.
Yes, well, happy Mother's Day, Woodmark Church. Moms, today we honor you. You know, whether you're a mom who has biological children or adoptive children, or whether you have spiritual children, we want to celebrate you today. You know, this week I was reflecting upon just motherhood, and I've been a mom for 13 years, but I feel like in every single season of my life, God has been teaching me something. He always has something to teach us, always has something to impart to us, and just want to share with you one thing that God just has been teaching me lately. You know, God has been teaching me to continue to sow. Continue to invest in your kid's life, understanding that not everything that you sow produces fruit right away. You know, the truth is what you sow will bring fruit, but it's going to bring fruit in like various seasons, in various times, in various intensities, in various degrees, but continue to sow. Just continue to sow, continue to speak words over your kids, words that God speaks over your children. Continue to create rituals that will cause your children to focus on Jesus. And continue to surround them with people that will just really cultivate their relationship with Jesus. Because how many of us know that the people that our kids spend time with will have an influence on them? You know, Russell and I, we purchased our home a few years ago. And we had this amazing lady who owned the home prior to us, but she planted all these trees for us. And I am so grateful to her for that. But what was really fascinating is some of those trees produced fruit like in a year or two. There was like a tree, our pear tree, because it took like 6 years for us to finally get like one pear. And there was this one tree like in the middle, and all that it produced like year in and year out was just green leaves. That's all that it produced. And I just remember like Googling it, trying to like be like, what tree is this? Like, what is this supposed to produce? Will it produce anything? I like remember making a plan of how we were gonna rip it out because it only had leaves and they weren't so pretty. You guys, but there was this one spring. Like along with the leaves came the most beautiful white flowers. And it decorated my whole backyard. You know, and I don't know, like, as you're sowing, I don't know what you're seeing. If you're just seeing green leaves, if you're wondering, you're longing for those white flowers or you're longing for some beauty, but you're just seeing green leaves. I just want to say, don't get discouraged. Don't give up. Like, continue to fertilize. Continue to water. Continue to plant. Continue to pray. Continue to prune, and you will see fruits, Mom. Just don't minimize the role that you play in your children's lives. You guys are capable. You guys are valuable. And in Christ, you have everything that you need to raise your children. And I love this quote. It says, to the world, you are a mother. But to your family, you are the world.
Wow. That was touching. Happy Mother's Day. We're excited to celebrate this day with you. I want to make a couple short announcements, and then we're going to get to a special treat for all of us. The first announcement is tomorrow night, we're going to have a special team meeting, our Dream Team Taco Night. And so if you are a part of Woodmark Church and you're part of our team, you serve in some capacities, or maybe you want to serve in some capacity, I want to invite you tomorrow night. We're having our team taco night here. Maybe you're saying, hey, you know what? I want to serve, but I just want to kind of get to see this team a little bit up close, what they are. We're meeting tomorrow night, 7 p.m. here at the church. Our second announcement is for young adults. If you're in this room and you're a young adult, or maybe you know a young adult, we meet right now every other week, and this week we're meeting at Visible Coffee on Tuesday night at 7 p.m. The coffee's shutting down completely, but then open it up for us. We're going to have a time of worship, a message, and it's just going to be a fun night at a coffee. It's a coffee shop takeover. So if you know a young adult, would love to invite you Tuesday night to our gathering, Visible Coffee here in Kirkland. I know there's a Mill Creek location, but the one in Kirkland. And then we're doing something similar with students on Wednesday night, middle school, high school students. So if you have a middle school or high school student, we'd love for you to join us Wednesday night. If you're new to Woodmark, on June 12th, we have a special class called Discover Woodmark. It'll happen right after service for 1 hour, where lunch and childcare will be provided. And so if you've, maybe this is your first time, or maybe you've come a couple times, and you just want to learn a little bit more about Woodmark Church and what we believe and what we're about and why we do what we do, Discover Woodmark is that class for you. It's happening June 12th, right after service, and we'd love for you to sign up if you can on our app or on our website. That way we just know how much lunch is to pre-order and how many people to prepare for. And then we have a special event coming up for our ladies.
Yes.
I'm going to have my wife share.
22nd, you guys, at 5 p.m., we are going to have a ladies' night. We are better when we're together, so please make plans to attend. It will be at the Bauer Center, so look at our go on our website or on our app for directions.
Awesome. So May 22nd, that's a Sunday night. Ladies, mark it on your calendar. Brothers, mark it on your calendar. Maybe we're going to go bowling together with our kids. All right, we'll find a bowling place open. We'll take the kids, and the ladies can have a great evening together. Before we pass it on to a video, our kids stepped in today to watch the kids' video that we made. Just want to say thank you for all of those that have chosen Woodmark to be something you invest in financially as well. You know, it takes resources to do what we do as a community. And we're doing projects within our church and growing, and then we're doing projects outside of our church. Right now, last month, you know, as a new church plant, we're always month to month, we're like, well, are we going to meet our budget? And last month, it was a miracle, because in the last 2-3 days, we were able to share with our teams, like, we made it this month. And but then we had to purchase some new things for our church. As you see these speakers that are here, they're standing on a pole, they're going to be hung up. And so we had to do some new purchases as a church outside of our normal monthly expenses, just about $12,000 in the speakers alone. And so want to encourage you, if you do have some resources that you want to allocate to ministry, to the church, the local church, these funds can be a blessing to us in this season as a church plant. We don't pass the plate in our church, but you can give online, you can give on our app, or there is a bucket at the way out when you leave, you can give that way as well.
Yeah,
Now we have a special treat for you. We have a little video that our kids did for us. And then the following service, we will have ice cream that's available. Snoqualmie ice cream was really generous.
Yeah, Snoqualmie ice cream, donated ice cream for all of you here today. It's beautiful cups. And so after service, when you leave, you all get ice cream today. But let's watch the video together.
My mom's like a very energetic person.
That she takes us walking. I love most about her is that she's pretty and I like her a lot.
I like her and she does school with me.
I love when she makes the youngest for me.
That she cooks for me and she takes care of me.
She gives me lots of hugs.
She's nice.
She gives me yummy lunch for school.
Put me to bed.
How she takes care of me, she loves me.
She cooks really good food and that she's really nice.
That she drives me to church and that she cooks for me.
Always kiss me and never let go.
I like that she bakes really good.
She's nice, she's loving and she's caring and she gets me stuff.
She loves me.
Go to school.
She always has a clean but light bulb.
She always calls me Bugs or Bug Bugs.
I love her.
She always says that she loves me and she cares about me and she does stuff for me.
Good job.
I love you.
I'm good.
She says that she loves me.
That she loves me.
I mean, other words.
That she loves me.
To go to bed.
She says to take a bath.
When I don't really feel good, she said, I hope you feel better.
She loves to cook.
She loves to cook.
She loves to take walks.
Work so hard to eat.
Making macarons.
She likes to either plan our school or do some other thing like paint or do some other thing.
Take walks.
She loves to go out to the park or somewhere fun.
Well, she likes to garden with me.
Everything.
Take us to the park.
She loves to cook and she loves to sit down on my deck and read a book.
She likes to snuggle with my dog.
Eat chocolate.
Take care of her kids and spend time with us.
That she's really good at art and takes care of the family when she needs to.
Mostly dad, but a lot of my mom.
My dad.
Mom.
Mom. Actually, dad. Cannot cook.
Mom.
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 Dad. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Mom. I love you, and you're the reason I'm here right now. Thank you.
Because you're a really great blessing,
I'm
so
thankful
about her.
I say that I love her.
I love you so
much. I love this.
Sing her a song on piano and say that I love her.
I love you so much too.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day and that I love her really much.
Happy Mother's Day.
That I really love her and she's so pretty.
That I love her.
I love you and thank you for the food that you make for me.
That I love her.
That I love her.
I hope you have a good day.
That I hope you get
lot of good stuff. And I hope you get to properly sleep in a little bit.
And I love her so much.
Please stand for the reading of the Lord's Word. The teaching text today is from Galatians 5:22. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. The next text is from John 20:19 through 23. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Tina. Woodmark Church, happy Mother's Day to everyone here. My name is Paul. I'm part of the teaching team, and it's a joy and a privilege and an honor to be able to share God's word with every one of you guys here today. As most of you guys are familiar and aware, we've been going through a series called Practicing Resurrection, and on the docket today is a word on peace. I was speaking to a friend a few months ago, and on the surface, seemingly everything is going well in his life. He has a few kids, he's married, he has a decent job, a decent income, he has a house that he owns, he does not rent. He has a good community around him, he is even able to travel a few times a year. Yet when being honest, under the surface, there's a gnawing anxiety that is sitting with him, that is present. It's a sense that everything will be taken away from me, that we are headed into a Great Depression, that possibly I have to move somewhere else to a different place to save my family. It's this gnawing sense of anxiety. And there's this level of incongruity. On the surface, everything seems fine. On the surface, he has achieved all of the markers of success. But underneath, there is this anxiety that lays hold of him. His story, particular story, gives shape and gives voice to a broader consensus in our culture today. Steven Pinker wrote a book a number of years ago titled Enlightenment Now. And what he does in this book is attempt and highlight the many metrics of success, of where we are as a culture, essentially highlighting how we have never had it better than we do now. As a culture living in the West, living today in the modern world, no one has lived as well as we are. And the metrics he uses are the income and poverty ratio. Things that he looks at is literacy. It's like at an all-time high. He looks at health and the longevity of life, how people have health and they're living longer. He's looking at the overall lifestyle, at the autonomy, at the fact that we're able to travel, right? Within a day to any part of the world. Essentially what he's saying is we're living in a golden age. Yet, with all the apparent well-being, with all of the luxurious lifestyle, maybe that is on offer for you and I today, what he fails to account is underneath all of that well-being, there is this pervasiveness of a loss of meaning, a loss of hope, a deep anxiety that has gripped our cultural consciousness. This is what he is failing to recognize. We, in the words of one writer, are living in an epidemic of anxiety. America is now officially the most anxious nation in the world. Just going to throw that out for you guys in case you were wondering where we stand. Every generation for the last three generations is three times more likely to experience depression than the previous generation. It's just accelerating and accelerating and accelerating. Almost one in five people in the United States wrestle with anxiety-related mental issues. One in four teenagers struggle with anxiety disorders. And one study says the average child today exhibits the same level of anxiety as the average psychiatric patient in the 1950s. What's happening? What's going on? How have we come to a place where anxiety has gripped us and gripped our culture? How are we living in this age of anxiety? How did we get here? The happiness professor at Yale, writing in the New York Times a few months ago, she says, quote, "Anxiety is destroying my students." Destroying them. And she's supposed to be a happiness professor and offer, you know, good mood and good feelings and good vibes. And she's saying, listen, anxiety is destroying my students. What is anxiety? What is anxiety? One definition has it this way: a feeling of worry, nervousness, or unease, typically about an imminent event or something with an uncertain outcome. Or probably my favorite definition of anxiety, it's a little bit shorter, a little bit more succinct: imagining the future without Jesus in it. A level of anxiety. And obviously what's correlated and what's associated with anxiety is this idea of fear. And we all understand, we all have experienced fear, right? We've all encountered in different moments. And fear from one side is good. From one side, it's healthy. From one side, fear is needed, right? Like your child needs to be afraid of the stove and the fire, right? That's good. But there's also a destructive level to fear that creates and produces anxiety. Anxiety is when fear takes over your mind. Anxiety is when fear moves from the tangible to the hypothetical. Anxiety is when the what-ifs of life suffocate your brain. Anxiety is when you can't fall asleep at night, when your mind won't turn off. Anxiety is mental. It takes place in the realm of the mind. And we've all experienced this. We've all walked through seasons of anxiety at different moments and different times. And you see, anxiety is viewed as an individual ailment. And indeed, in many experiences, it is. In many instances, your anxiety is very particular to who you are. You experience it personally. But there is also another feature to anxiety. There is a structural element to it, where it takes people groups into a state of anxiety. One thinker puts it this way. He writes, quote, "We must differentiate between the individual mental health challenge of anxiety." That's a thing. There's a mental health of anxiety that I'm not necessarily speaking as much on, which is a minority of individuals in every cultural experience, and the systemic anxiety that our contemporary culture structures create. What this writer is saying essentially are there is structural elements of anxiety that comes over cultures, over a particular people group, over a particular community. Like, we can have structural anxiety even within this congregation. All I have to do is just bring in fear, panic, and bad news, right? And everyone's going to walk out being a little bit anxious. How does anxiety get a structural element? Alan Friedman, a leading scholar, noted that anxiety escalates as society is overwhelmed by the quantity and speed of change. the more societies accelerate and change, and the speed of change is more profound, the more societies fall into a state of anxiety. Would it be safe to say that we have never experienced such accelerated change as our modern West? Would you be surprised if I told you the advent, the invention of internet has shaped our society in ways that no other culture group has ever experienced? And notice, what the goal of, notice the institutions around us. What is the goal of an institution? What are they there to provide? From one side, institutions provide some sense of cohesion and identity. What they do is they buffer us out from some of the anxiety that humans commonly experience throughout history. Institutions help absorb that anxiety into themselves. And it's a fact among political scientists that well-functioning and healthy institutions are the bedrock of peaceful and prosperous societies. Just imagine the healthcare system. If it's going well, if you trust the healthcare system, you are at ease. Even if you get a sickness, you're like, oh man, I can go to the hospital, I feel good. You know, they're gonna fix everything, they're gonna take care of me. But what happens when the institutions themselves become exposed? What happens when the institutions that are supposed to help absorb the anxiety that humans feel, they themselves are corrupted and you no longer trust them? And this is largely what is happening, where many people find the institutions are no longer credible. For example, government, media, health, Hollywood, Silicon Valley, Wall Street, even parts and segments of church are all being exposed in our cultural moment, are all being exposed in various ways. And hear this, when institutions are exposed, individuals, you and I, are left to absorb the culture's anxiety. We are left to embrace it, to absorb it. Anxiety then becomes a systemic phenomenon. And so where we live, it's a comfortable age. We have much good in this world, but there is also anxiety that is a contagion in our modern West. It's like a virus. It's like a cold where the mood of anxiety sweeps from one person to another to another. And the irony is, this all comes when peace is the hottest cultural commodity. Like, who here does not want peace? Who here does not want to live in a state of peace? Like, even out of all of the fruit of the Spirit, besides love, I think peace is the hottest commodity, right? Everybody wants peace. No one thinks peace is a bad idea. No one's like, you know what? I'm anti-peace. You know what? Like, this whole peace idea, that's not for me. That's like for my neighbor. I just love it when it's just chaos and chaotic and full of anxiety. Nobody, right? Anybody here like that? No, right? And notice that we promote peace. We have social justice causes. We have activism. We have philanthropy. We have all of these conduits and ways to promote human peace and promote peace in our world. Peace is a buzzword. We have peace activists, peace rallies. We have the Nobel Peace Prize. We have cities of peace. We even have a universally recognized sign of peace, right? Like, peace is a big deal. We love this concept. And yet, there is a sense of incongruence between our love, desire, and longing for peace and the chaos and anxiety that we actually experience in our modern West, in our age. Take with me just the past few years, COVID, what COVID has done to accelerate this anxious mood and anxious environment in our culture at large and even in the world, where you feel like you're no longer in control. Go with me to the war in Ukraine. all of a sudden this idea of peace, somewhat seemingly peace, all of a sudden might actually end and lead us into a global war. And then you turn on the news and you hear talks of nukes and you're like, what? Like, I'm just trying to survive. And all of a sudden the pundits on the radio or on the newscast are talking about nuclear war. Speaking of nuclear war, C.S. Lewis, writing in 1948, speaks about living in the atomic age. And he highlights how this was just a few years after the two atom bombs were dropped on Nagasaki and Hiroshima. And countries were accelerating their desire to stockpile, to create, to figure out how to develop atom bombs or nuclear warheads, right? It became this arms race. How are we going to do it? And America and Russia, the U.S. and Russia eventually, or the Soviet Union to be more precise, eventually have this race of who can stockpile more nuclear weapons. And C.S. Lewis says about this atomic age, people became anxious, people became fearful, the mood was, what are we going to do? How are we going to live? How are we going to survive? And Lewis writes a little essay, and he says essentially, listen, we are thinking a little too great deal on this subject. We're thinking about it a little too much. How are we to live is the question everyone is asking. And he says, how would you live in the plague in the 16th century? How would you live in the Viking Age when raiders would storm your village and take your woman and your kids? How would you live in the age of cancer, motor accidents, or 100 other threats? And then he says, do not let us begin to exaggerate the novelty of our situation. Let's not exaggerate. He says, it is perfectly ridiculous to go about whimpering and drawing long faces because the scientists have added one more chance of painful and premature death to a world already bristled with such chances, and in which death itself was not a chance at all, but a certainty. And I wanted to just highlight and quote this one section that is truly profound. Listen to what he says. This is the first point to be made, and the first action to be taken is to pool ourselves together. If we are all going to be destroyed by an atom bomb, let that bomb, when it comes, find us doing sensible and human things. Praying, working, teaching, reading, listening to music, bathing the children, playing tennis, chatting to our friends over a pint and a game of darts. Not huddled together like frightened sheep and thinking about bombs. They may break our bodies, but they need not dominate our minds. In other words, what he is saying is, though we live in an anxious age, we do not have to live people full of anxiety. While we live in an anxious age, you and I can live as people that are at peace, people that experience this equilibrium, people that experience and walk in a posture of peace. That is what he is saying, which begs the question, is it possible? Is it possible to live in a state of peace in the chaos of the modern world when news and everything that's going on throughout the world is within a click of Twitter or Instagram or your favorite news source or whatever? Is it possible to live with peace in the modern world? I think so. Let's look at the text before us. We see how John highlights the disciples. What's their posture? They are in fear. And it's not just any ordinary fear. It's the kind of fear where it says the doors are bolted shut, right? Like, this is a next level form of fear. This is a group of people who are afraid. What are they afraid of? Everything they experienced over the past three years has come to a sudden halt with the death of the Son of God. Think with me for a minute. There has been consequential moments and events throughout human history. You can, you know, refer back to the World War II. You can go back maybe to the bubonic plague. You can look at different moments throughout history that were like, wow, this is huge. I propose that one of the most dramatic events in history was the death of the Son of God. Imagine God was killed. God died and we killed him. Biblical writers will speak about this event as the death of God, as the beginning of the last days. Why? Because there is nothing more grave and more consequential than the death of the Son of God, right? And so many writers, they speak about the last days, not as something somewhere out there in the future. No, they speak about we're living in the last days. They're talking about it then. Why? Because the death of God was one of the greatest moments in history, and it started a process that the biblical writers would go on to refer to as the last days. And so it goes dark. Their movement has ended. The Messiah is dead. And this group of people are huddled in a room with the door bolted shut, afraid, full of fear. We've all can envision this picture, right? We can all envision this image. You are huddled in a group afraid. Maybe you're huddled within the thoughts in your head of what tomorrow is going to bring. You are afraid. Maybe you're gathering with friends and you're just conversating and chatting and talking. You are afraid what is going to happen with tomorrow's world. Maybe you're huddled online following events halfway across the world, and you are in fear. And listen, Jesus comes into the midst of them with the word for the ages. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Imagine hearing these words of Jesus over your situation and what you are going through in your life right now. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Does he not understand what is happening? Is Jesus kind of divorced from reality? Is Jesus the only one who doesn't understand the context that everything has found itself in? Is Jesus kind of oblivious to the cultural anxiety that has gripped us? Jesus comes with the word of peace. Jesus, are you not familiar? Are you not aware of the war in Ukraine, though? Are you not aware that we are still somewhat dealing with COVID? And yet the word is peace be with you. What is Jesus attempting to pass on to these frightened disciples? What is Jesus offering to these people who are huddled in a room, doors bolted shut because they are afraid? What is he attempting to relay for them to sort of catch? It's this word peace. Now, what is peace? It is translated in the Greek as Irene. That's where the name Irene comes from. Do we have any Irenes in the house? Yes, Sister Irina, there you go. It is a name of peace. So if you want some peace, you know who to go to after the service today, right? And so many of us, we hear this word and we use peace in only one context. For us, peace is the absence of conflict or the absence of war. That's our context for peace. One historian, philosopher Will Durant, made an estimation a number of years ago, and he highlighted and he took account the last 3,124 years of recorded human history. And he says, out of the last 3,100 years, do you know how many years there was no war on the earth? Only 268 of them. A total of 92% of recorded world history has been a time of war and conflict at various moments. And so peace is not just the absence of war. Peace is not just no conflict. Peace is actually something much bigger and something much better, my brothers and sisters. When Jesus and the writers of the New Testament speak about peace, it was an absolutely loaded word for the ancient Jewish audience. One writer attempted to define or describe peace puts it this way: peace means wholeness, balance, well-being, safety, and prosperity. Another writer puts it this way: peace is a state of mind, heart, body, and soul. It is the freedom to breathe even in the face of great challenges and chaos. Peace is the river in the desert, not on the other side of it. And one more writer puts it this way: peace is harmony, tranquility, wholeness, well-being, salvation of the total person, reconciliation of persons and societies to God, as well as to one another. So we see how this word peace is an absolutely loaded word. Do you know why? Because the word peace, it actually has its roots in the Hebrew scriptures. It's not just this New Testament word that Jesus and the writers came up with. No, it actually has this long, long tradition. Do you know what the word for peace in the Hebrew Bible is? Anybody guess? Shalom. That's right. Come on, somebody. I know you've heard the word shalom before, right? To this day, Jews will use this word as a greeting over one another. Shalom. When I was in Israel a few years back, I walk into a restaurant, and the words that I hear is shalom. I'm like, shalom you back, brother. Like, peace be upon you, right? And it's just this shalom you, shalom me. And it's just like, come on, let's carry the peace, right? And we love it. We love this word of shalom. Shalom is a one-word reference to the Garden of Eden. Shalom is a short way to tell the Genesis 1 and 2 story. That was a place of shalom, a world as God intended it to be. It was a world of shalom. Eden literally means delight. Did you guys know that? The garden was a place of shalom. It was a place of peace, wholeness, joy, vitality. It was full of life. That was Genesis 1 and 2. Humans, you and I, my brother, my sister, were created to live in shalom. We were created to live in a state of peace in our mind, in our heart, in our very being, in our very essence, to be in peace, mainly in peace with God. Mainly in peace with God. Because when peace with God exists, then there can become peace everywhere else. It can flow out into every other corner and pocket of our lives. If you're familiar with the biblical story, humans decide freedom for themselves, freedom from God. They seize autonomy. They become filled with the desire to become gods themselves. That is the biblical story. And it is this drive for freedom from God that is the true source of relational anxiety that infects every human relationship that we have. One writer, Mark Sayers, a pastor in Australia, who I appreciate very much, says this: the seed of the anxiety that invades and infects human social systems is found in the disconnection from the presence of God, which occurred in the garden. This is the engine that powers both the toxic anxiety in our social systems, which worships conformity at the cost of growth, and independency, which worships at the altar of radical freedom. In our disconnection from God, we rebel against responsibility, relationships, and life-giving rules. Thus, anxiety and independency live in a codependent relationship. Our disconnection to God becomes the seed, becomes the avenue, becomes the door by which we become an anxious people, because we are disconnected from the source of peace. And listen, what Jesus does on this Easter morning that we read about in the text is he comes out with a word of peace. What humans have longed to hear for millennia: peace be over you, peace be over me. The future has stepped into the present with the word of peace. And so what this is essentially highlighting, what Jesus is saying, is that the shalom of the garden, shalom of Genesis 1 and 2, it can be experienced even in your life, even in my life today. The shalom of the garden, the intention of God, experienced, and we can experience it in the midst of a culture that is gripped by anxiety and fear. You can live in a state of peace. It's on offer for you. It's an offer for me. Who here needs to hear a word of peace? Who here has been gripped by thoughts and worries of tomorrow and the future, and you need to hear a word of peace? Who here is wondering about the difficulty of dealing with other humans and the tensions that come with just dealing with relationships, and you need to hear a word of peace? Who here is looking at this moment today and you're wondering, what is tomorrow going to bring for my kids? Like, should I even have any more kids? Because, like, it's so uncertain today. Who needs to hear a word of peace? How can Jesus come with this kind of pronouncement? How is Jesus able to stand in a group of people who are gripped with fear, filled with anxiety, and speak a word of peace to these individuals? How is Paul able to speak a word of peace to the church in Philippi? He is under arrest by Rome. How is Paul able to say, listen, I am filled with peace. The peace of God is able to fill my heart. How is he able to live in this kind of posture? How is Peter able to speak a word of peace to the churches in Asia Minor who are under the boot of empire, who are being persecuted and killed off? How is Peter able to speak to this group of people and say, listen, the peace of God will be over you? How is that possible? Notice they connect the source of peace directly with what Jesus accomplished through his life, death, and resurrection. This idea of peace was sort of a common concept in the ancient world. Do you know why? Because you know what Caesar was offering to the world? You guessed it, peace. Pax Romana, what was that all about? Roman peace. It was this idea that when he returned to the capital, Augustine did, he proclaimed that he has finally brought peace to the whole world. But how did this peace happen? How was this peace accomplished? He would come into a village, he would come into a city, and he says, listen, you want my peace? No? Well, he kills them off. And so his form of peace was achieved by killing off enemies, by killing off those who opposed, by anyone who was on the outside of the empire. That was the way peace was accomplished. And Jesus comes onto the scene. And Paul, look how he talks about this Jesus and what he does in Colossians 1. He says, for in him the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven. Why? Making peace by the blood of the cross. Paul, writing to another church community, he says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ, for he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down the dividing wall of hostility. The biblical writers keep on insisting that through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, peace has been made. Peace has been made. Jesus is the anti-Caesar. He doesn't offer peace through violence, but through sacrificial giving of his very own life. He absorbs all the evil, all the injustice of the world, and in return, he offers you and I a word of peace. Church, our deepest source of alienation, namely being cut off from God, namely being disconnected from God. Our deepest source of anxiety is being disconnected and removed and at a distance from God. And what the cross does is bring us together. What the cross does is speak a word of peace. Listen, between you and God, there is now peace. There is now peace. The greatest human need is to be reconciled to God. It is to have the face of God directed towards you. It is to have the peace of God, to find out, listen, God is not angry. And in the cross, the word that Jesus speaks, peace between you and God, peace in our relationships, peace in our mind, peace, even going through difficult moments, even going through difficult season, you and I can live and experience a sense of peace. You might be in this place today, you're uncertain where you stand with God. You might have lost hope. You might have been at one time sort of believing. At one time, you might have been attending church. At one time, you might have been thinking that you and God, you know, maybe he exists somewhere out there. But, you know, today comes a moment where you're like, you know, I don't know where I stand. I don't know what God thinks of me. I don't know how I can trust and believe in this God. Listen, the word for you, my brother and sister, is that God wants to speak a word of peace. He has done everything to bridge that chasm, that divide, and give you and offer you peace. Notice peace is at the center of Jesus' life in the kingdom. And the vision of Jesus and the New Testament writers is the church as a community of peace. This is a big deal for the early Jesus community, for Jesus himself, that you and I would become a community of peacemakers. Now, this whole idea of Jesus giving peace, peace with God, peace with my neighbor, peace with other people, it sounds good on the surface. It sounds beautiful. Yes, I love that idea. I love that posture. But notice some of us would have that question, well, how do I live in that posture today? How do I live this out? And for Paul, this word of peace, this idea of peace is not just a static thing that happened some long time ago. No. It's an ongoing reality that you and I are invited to live in today to become people of peace. Notice, Paul describes God to the Philippian church as what? The God of peace. Jesus comes as what? The Prince of Peace. And the Holy Spirit's work in your and my life is to produce the fruit of peace in your life. That you and I would become a person that carries and embodies this idea of peace. In a culture gripped with anxiety, in a culture afraid of what tomorrow is going to bring, that you and I would walk as people of peace. In other words, of putting that is a non-anxious presence. A non-anxious presence. Imagine you're driving your car with a buddy of yours, and all of a sudden you hear something muffled sound in the engine, and your car dies. What happens? You're like on the freeway or whatever. What's your initial mood? Oh my gosh, how am I going to get this? How am I going to get and work out of this situation? But then you remember your buddy that's sitting next to you is a mechanic, and all of a sudden you relax. Ah, he got this, right? Imagine you're working on a project and your computer crashes, and you're like, oh my goodness, everything that I worked for, gone. And you're gripped with fear and anxiety, and what am I going to do here? But then you remember your neighbor is a computer programmer, and you call him in, and he's able to fix it. There's a level of peace that comes over you. Imagine you're a young couple who just gave birth to a child, and 1,000 issues surface. A fever hits, a cough, some little red marks on the skin. What is your posture? One is, I'm afraid, I'm kind of scared. What do I do? This is all new. But what do you have on speed dial? Your mom, right? Because you know when you call mom, she's going to say, send me a picture. Let me see what this red mark, oh, this is nothing. It's like, put a little dose of this, you know, give him a little bit of tea, chamomile or something like that. And you know that it all fixes itself, right? Why? Because a mom is a source of peace. She understands how to navigate. And the question is, in our culture, when anxiety is so rampant, when anxiety is just the air that we breathe, do you know what's needed? What God wants to do in our culture, in our communities, is for you and I to be a non-anxious presence, that we become people who offer peace to an anxious world. How does this happen? How can we do this? Listen to what Jesus says. Peace be yours. He comes into their midst and says, peace be yours. Just as the Father has sent me, so now I am sending you. In other words, what Jesus was for the world, you and I are invited to be for our community. Jesus carried peace. peace, and you and I are invited to be that as well, this non-anxious presence. And so what I want to do is just offer us three images of what this looks like, and then two practices as we end and close out. The first image happened a few years ago. There was a clash in Ukraine between the police and the protesters, and it was getting rowdy, and it was getting serious, right? Like, people were getting hurt. And into the center of that place came a group of priests. Can we have an image of them up here? And they stand holding the cross, essentially saying, there is another way. There is another way. Between two rioting forces, a little group of priests say, listen, we are going to be peacemakers between these two polarizing groups of people, right? It is this idea of a non-anxious presence. One of my favorite stories, images, comes when the disciples encounter a storm. And these are fishermen. They've encountered many storms, but this particular storm just lands them into a state of anxiety and fear. And a storm was a big deal in the ancient world because water signified like chaos, and it was like a spiritual force for many of them. And you see here, the text highlights the massive contrast between Jesus and the disciples. They are all in fear. They're all afraid. They're all panicking. What are we going to do? And Jesus on the other side is sleeping in the boat. Like, just sleeping, taking a nap. And it just shows and highlights the vast contrast that can exist in one situation between two groups of people. Some are running in panic, afraid, full of anxiety. The other is a non-anxious presence. Sister Marina shared a few days ago at small group a story when she was flying across the Atlantic Ocean. She gets on the airplane, and there's an elderly woman, a physician of sorts, who has a phobia of flying. And she has like a prescription to like carry alcohol to maybe try to calm her when it gets a little too chaotic, right? And she sits down right next to Marina, shaking out of fear because she's about to take off. And Marina looks at her and says, can I pray over you? And this woman says, absolutely. Marina lays a hand and prays over her. And this woman falls asleep. 11 hours later, as they are getting ready to land, she wakes this woman up and she says, where am I? And this woman, and Marina says, we are landing, sister. And she is blown away. What just happened? She sat down next to a non-anxious presence, someone that offered peace in that moment. So how can we become these kind of people? How can we carry peace, embody this non-anxious presence in our world today? Two brief thoughts to close out here. One, the text says, Jesus came and stood right in the middle of them and says, peace. Literally, it says, in the very center, Jesus comes with the word of peace. Think with me, what usually brings anxiety into our lives when we make certain things the center, right? One person places their financial well-being at the center, that becomes a source of anxiety. One person places their kids at the center, that becomes a source of anxiety. Another person places status and career at the center, that becomes a place of your anxiety. And the word of Jesus is he comes at the center. And from the center, when he's at the center, that is where peace is able to trickle out over our lives and over our minds. The danger is whenever we place certain things at the center, they always become the source of anxiety and fear over life. Because the thought is, what if I lose them? What if they're gone? What if I can't hold on to it? What if I lose this job? What if my relationship with my kid falters, right? What if he doesn't get into the school that I want him to get into? That becomes the source of anxiety. Dallas Willard talks about how he, when he had his first boy, his greatest desire was, he says, I couldn't accept the fact that this little creature was going out into a world over which I had no control. And he says, you never get over being a parent. You can't divorce your kids, but you can surrender them to God. You can give them to God. He says, when I had my kid, I was so gripped by anxiety. What if something's not going to work out? What if I'm not going to be there for him when he's going to need me here? And he says, there comes a moment where you have to surrender them to God. And so the peace of God, my brother and sister, comes when Christ is at the center, not the circumference. When Jesus is at the center, not on the outskirts, not as a secondary or third thing in your life. When we can see him as the center. And notice how Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 10. He says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. How? We take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Paul understood, like, there's a lot of things that grapple for the central focus of our mind. But I take every thought captive to obey Christ so that I can make Christ at the center, so that I can say to listen, whatever the culture, whatever my anxiety, whatever my mood, whatever my mind is telling me at this given moment, to give all of my attention to focus everything, for this to be the most important thing in my life. Listen, Paul says we can train our mind to demolish these ideas so that Christ can be the center, so that we can live out of a posture where we obey Christ. What does Christ have to say about our lives? What does Christ have to say about us, even if we lose our job? What does Christ say about us, even when things are seeming to go chaotic? We allow Christ to get the central word, the central focus of our mind and our thinking. This is where it begins. There's been so much research and study done on this issue that out of the mind flow who we become as individuals. How you think matters. And so that's the first thing. And the second thought to end is this idea. Jesus comes into the midst, into the very center of the room, and he offers them a word of peace. And after offering a word of peace, he breathes the Holy Spirit and says, receive the Holy Spirit. And obviously, in one sense, he's alluding to the Genesis 1 story where God breathes life into male and female, right? Into the man, Adam and Eve. But from another side, what Jesus is doing is he is releasing the Holy Spirit over this community. In the words of Gordon Fee, God's empowering presence over this community. And many of us, we can fall into the temptation of viewing the fruit of the Spirit as basic commands. I have to become more peaceful, or I have to become more loving, or I have to become more joyful. But notice when you read this passage, there isn't even a single command. Oh, become more peaceful. No, it's the fruit. It's just stating a fact. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. These all flow out of a heart, out of a particular disposition of the heart. You become a person of love, joy, and peace. Paul is describing the natural effect of a life lived by the Spirit. Mark Sayers, once again, says it this way: the root of our anxiety is our disconnection from God. This means we cannot be a non-anxious presence without God's presence. To do so is simply a project of human striving, which attempts to solve anxiety in the world, but only adds to it. What we need, what you and I need, my brothers and sisters, is a breathing of the Holy Spirit over us. The empowering presence of God, that it would fill our hearts and our minds. Because truly what we were created to be is one with God. It is to know God, to live for God. And when that is in alignment, peace is able to settle over our minds. The only command in the text in Galatians is what? To keep the step in the Spirit. Keep in step with the Spirit. Paul doesn't say, listen, become or do love or practice love or all of that. No, no. There's just one prescription. There's just one command. Hey, keep in step with the Spirit. Why? Because Paul knows when we are in step with the Spirit of God, we can have the fruit of the Spirit cultivated in our lives. We can become people of love, joy, and peace. When we allow the Holy Spirit day in and day out, week in and week out, to have control, to have influence, to have a way with us, we open ourselves up that we embody the fruit that the Spirit brings. And church, I want to just say, we want to be a church like this. Woodmark Church, we want to be a church that longs for the empowering presence of God. The presence of God would form our mind and all of the anxious thoughts and moods that we have, that the peace of God would flow out of our communion and our experience of practicing God's presence. This is why I think in the fall we're leaning towards doing a series on practicing the presence of God. Different postures, different ways, different practices, that we can be attuned to the voice of the Holy Spirit, that we can walk in the favor of God. Why? Because we want the words of Jesus, receive the Holy Spirit, to be repeated again and again and again. We want to receive and experience all the Spirit has to offer. So Jesus comes in their midst, right into the center, and breathes this word, receive the Holy Spirit. We can do that even right now. Let's stand and pray. God, our age is one that is anxious. You know our hearts. You know our minds. You know where we are as individuals, as a community, and as a culture. And even in the midst of our chaos in our modern moment, God, you still offer us and speak to us words peace. And I pray over my brothers and sisters today, those who are going through moments of difficulty, those who can't seem to quench all the negative thoughts, all the worrisome thoughts in their mind. They are gripped in the hands and in the grips of anxiety. God, I pray during this time of prayer, may your Holy Spirit come. Jesus, breathe your Holy Spirit once again. And may you speak a word of peace to every individual here. During this time of worship, we want to become non-anxious presence. May you help us to become such people in our moment and in our world today. Church, as we're going to go into a time of worship, if you have, maybe you've been struggling with anxiety, maybe you can't get rid of the thoughts of just what is tomorrow going to bring? What am I going to do tomorrow? The future, and you're just gripped and in the throngs of anxiety, and you wanted maybe a minister, a lady, a pastor to lay a hand over you and pray, join you in just praying peace over you. This is a beautiful time for that opportunity. We're going to go into a time of singing.
What gift of love could I offer to a king? What a weight of worth could be held within my offering? When he alone is worthy, a glory song is inscribed upon my heart, this treasure held in an alabaster jar. I pray to bring him all the glory. Praise God from whom all blessings.
Gathering. Thank you that you offer us words of peace. And so we pray as we go and leave this sanctuary that we will become people of peace, a non-anxious presence amongst our family, relatives, co-workers, neighbors, and so forth. We ask this in the name of the resurrected Christ. And everybody said, well, church, thanks for joining us today, worshiping with our church family. As you go, we do have ice cream. I know some of you came maybe just for that. That's fine. But as you go, the grace of God and the peace of God be over you. Blessings.